And here we are with another evening at quickfixgolf.com with all our friends out there on Wednesday nights at 8 o'clock Eastern Daylight Time, having a good time talking about golf, talking about the golf swing, and talking about everything we can imagine that it will improve your golf game. And we have with us tonight my partner in crime here, Darren DeMaley. Darren, say hello.
I'm from Myrtle Beach. That's where I'm at.
You're in Myrtle Beach?
Yay, right, Darren.
Now? Yay, in Myrtle Beach.
I'm in Myrtle.
Where's Mason? He's not on yet.
And it's raining again.
Is it raining again?
Raining again.
And Darren, why don't you introduce the guest that you brought on board for this evening?
Yeah, I'm really excited to have Dr. Bhrett McCabe on with us tonight. I came across the doc through a friend of mine, Michael Breed. And as everybody knows, I've spent a lot of time with Michael Breed, and he's influenced me quite a bit. And that's kind of where I ran into this gentleman. And he's really influenced me quite a bit on everything I do in my lessons. So I owe a lot of credit to him, and he doesn't really realize it. But I keep good tabs on him and use a lot of his thoughts when I'm coaching every day. And I think it'll help everyone here tonight to get a little glimpse into how we really need to think when we're swinging a golf club, because it's not just executing a shot, and that's where most people go to every time they hit a bad shot. Oh, I didn't execute properly. And Dr. Bhrett will share with us tonight that there's a lot more to it than just executing, like the mind side, you know, the mindset and the strategy that goes into it and the preparation, and there's luck involved there too. So I'm excited to hear what he has to say.
So before we start peppering you with some questions there, Doctor, let me blow your horn a second, because everybody knows who you are. He's founder of Mindside and licensed clinical psychologist holding a PhD degree in clinical psychology from Louisiana State, LSU.
Go Tigers!
Yay, Tigers! With an emphasis in behavioral medicine, having completed behavioral medicine, that's what I needed. My behavioral medicine in school was a paddle. Completed his internship at Brown University in Providence, Rhode Island. While an undergrad at LSU, Dr. McCabe was a four-year letterman on the baseball team and was a member of two national championship teams, three SEC championship teams, and a third college, three World College, College World Series teams. And he's a practicing sports and performance psychologist who's done numerous athletes. You can see all this information on his site. And what's the name of your website again, Doc? I've got it up here somewhere. I'm going to pull it back.
Yep, it's themindside.com.
Themindside.com. And we're going to show some of your books tonight on that. Now, I've got a couple of questions, and Darren, I'm sure you have some, but I'm going to throw one first. What is a mental skills consultant?
So a mental skills consultant is somebody who focuses on the way that you think, the way that you prepare, and focuses on the part of the body, the part of the game that's above the shoulders. And, you know, it's a growing industry. It's an industry that has quite a bit of variety and variability in the type of professionals that work in that setting. So for golfers or athletes across the spectrum, there's a lot of different people who can work in that area or who do provide services in that area. Typically, you can break it down into this. A clinical psychologist like myself, who specializes in sport, is licensed by the state, which means I have to answer to an ethics board and I have to answer to licensing guidelines and such. It means that they've completed a doctorate degree with an internship, which is like a one-year residency for like what a physician goes through. Then you also have people who are a little different, who have who come at it from a perspective of having a PhD in sports psychology. Like usually those come out of like Department of Kinesiologies. University of Tennessee has that kind of program. They're not specialized in the way that the person, you know, from an overall mental perspective of that person, you know, the positive or the struggle side. You know, as a clinician, I look at the entire spectrum as people who have sometimes issues with, you know, being depressed or anxious or having personality differences that may help them. A traditional sports psychologist is often who's got his PhD in kinesiology. Tends to come at it from an angle of, you know, sports science. So they tend to study more about the science of sport and exercise adoption. And then you have people who are mental skills consultants who just have a variety of different training, but have learned maybe a former player who's got a specialty in the interest level. Maybe learn something like, you know, meditation or mindfulness, and has brought that forward. So there's such variety. The fact is that you want to find somebody or learn from somebody who has information that can help you play the game better, that helps you tap into what you do and your strengths so that you can make it easy. It doesn't have to be signed. It doesn't have to be suspicious or magical. It just needs to be something that's relevant to you.
Now, what about playing lights out? What does that mean to you?
Playing lights out? Well, it's a mythical moment, honestly. And I want people to think about this in golf, is that the average player, the people who want to get better, and I'm an average player who plays on the weekends and plays with my friends, we all want more consistency in our game. Our tour players, the 10 or so tour players I work with on the PGA Tour, they all want more consistency in their game. But golf is not a game of consistency. Golf is actually a game of wide variety and variability. You're taking a ball and playing in a completely changing environment every single time. Every shot is different. Every shot is a challenge. Every shot has different demands. And it's not like hitting balls on the range. And so playing lights out is something where a player has that magical moment where they feel good and they feel like they achieved at such a high level. But the problem with that in golf is that's what we hang on to, and that's what we believe our standard should be. So if you have that really, really good round, you all of a sudden think that that's what your norm should be. And I'll tell you, working with tour players, they make 80% of their money on average in 5 events a year. So they play on average 25 to 30 events. So they're going to make 80% of their money in 5 or 6 events. And that holds for even the best of the best, the Tiger Woods at his best, Jordan Spieth at his best, and so on. What that means is about 20 to 25 events a year, they're playing somewhat average golf for them. So my goal is not always to help a player shoot their lowest rounds. And I've had one player shoot a 57 in a Alabama junior golf event, a kid by the name of Bobby Wyatt who played on tour. And one of my clients is a guy by the name of Steven Yeager who shot the first 58 in a PGA or Webb event. Did it a week before Jim Furyk. And so I've got players that have shot low, but I want their averages to be better. I want them to be ready to make, you know, I want them to turn on tour a 73 to a 71 versus trying to shoot the 65. When the 65 happens, it's usually easy. There's a lot of luck that happens. There's a lot of good things that happen. But golf is a game of dealing with the ups and the downs and not always the good. And it's dealing with the struggles and such like that. And the better that we can get at that, then we actually open ourselves up to play lights out.
Oh, that's a good answer. What can the average weekend golfer do mentally to improve their performance?
I think the first thing that you need to do as a weekend golfer is get rid of the potential word. Every golfer sees potential as that great round that they know that they can play. If you're a scratch golfer, you think you can go out and shoot 66. If you're a 5 handicap, you think you should shoot par. And we always anchor into those better rounds, and we ignore our average. What we need to do is see what our average is. So if we're a 10 handicap and we come in and shoot 82 to 83, that's a good round of golf. That's what we average play. How can we make that better? How can we get that one shot better? If we can accept that it's not going to be a perfect swing, that we have unique variances within ourselves. We all swing the club differently. We all have different body styles, and it's impossible for us to swing the club like Justin Thomas does. He does that for a living. He works on it all the time. His body is optimized for him. We can't do that. So the better thing is to look at how am I going to get this ball down the fairway to give myself the best chance to have the lowest score, and how can I reduce some of the trouble that I get myself into? I can't be perfect, and I even struggle with this. I have a dear friend of mine who's an elite instructor, top 100, top 50 guy that I spend a lot of time with. And I'll go in and see him, and I'll say, I'll be like, Mark, he goes, man, your posture is pitiful, and you have a super strong grip. But he goes, I'm not going to spend time changing your grip. You're a baseball player. You like that feel. And he said, your posture is bad because you're 6'5", and it's what makes you comfortable over the ball. He said, so I got to know your tendencies. Your main issue is if you take the club back on the inside, you make a big over-the-top move. If you take the club back on the outside and shorten your backswing, even though you have a down angle at attack, you hit it straight and you hit it far. So I'm not going to change anything. I'm just going to get you playing the best with what you have because I know what your work schedule is. And when I listen to him and I trust him, it works. And I still see myself on video and think, God, my posture is terrible. God, that grip is awful. But I'm a low handicap, and I can shoot low, and I can also shoot high. But I also have to understand that I teach for a living. I work for a living. I work 70, 80-hour weeks. The likelihood of me hitting balls is very slim. I have a 1,000-square-foot putting green indoors 15 feet from my office. I can chip and putt. I don't ever putt and chip on it. So when I'm going out to putt on in a round of golf, I've got to eliminate as many different thoughts as I can and try to get the ball in the hole the best I can. So the average weekend golfer, stop chasing this greatness and take what you have and make it the best that you have. It'll actually go a long way.
Darren, do you have any questions?
Yeah, I mean, that's a really great point. And I think, Bobby, that's what you and I do on a daily basis. We just try to identify tendencies and habits and make it real simple like that.
Well, one of the things I tell people in the one-day school is I say, look, I know one thing right now. You're not going to practice. It ain't going to happen.
Yep.
You got a real job. You got to work. You got two kids. You got this. You got that. You're going to go to the range Thursday night for an hour, and you think that's practice. That's not practice. So your best friend is wiffle balls in the backyard in a mirror. You got a full-length mirror at home. Get in front of that mirror like a ballet dancer and nag the swing fault into submission in front of the mirror. You got a shot at doing that. But, you're not going to practice enough to reprogram your body to go to a different place that easily. It just doesn't happen that easy.
It's impossible. And, to that point, Bobby, even more, I mean, I want you to think about it like this. Changing human behavior. First of all, the human brain, the motor system in the brain is not built to make consistent motor movements. So when we're always trying to get the club in the exact same position, we're actually going against how our brain functions. Our brain functions from a perspective of adaptability, not, creating the same movement every single time. If I asked each of you right now to touch your nose, you're going to do it with slight variations. And I think that's why probably Bubba Watson is the best example of embracing who he is and just playing with it, not chasing something else. Now, I don't believe he's never had a lesson. I know that's actually not true. It's what he defines as a lesson versus something else. I think he's brilliant. I mean, he's had people who've been around him and helped him in the past. And I think we should all embrace what Bubba does. I think we should all learn from how Bubba plays the game. Bubba plays the game where everything is making it work. If he's got that day a 20-yard cut, he plays a 20-yard cut. He doesn't go back and chase why he's not squaring up the club face and why he's not doing it right and why was he doing it so good in his lesson. He takes that information and he takes his team and the people that are around him and makes himself a better player because of that.
I agree 100%. Let's take a look. How can an average golfer better prepare to play golf? Because that's something I work on with folks to say. They just, they get to the golf course at 10:25. They got a 10:30 starting time. They grab their sticks out of the truck. They rush out, pay for the green fee, and go. You can't do that.
Well, my tour players do that too, and it drives me nuts. On Tuesdays, it absolutely drives me nuts. I'll ask them. I'll text them, and I'm, managing a bunch of guys there during the day, and I'll say, hey, what time are we going to go out and walk 9 holes? And they're like, hey, why don't we work on the range at 10? I get out on the range at 10, and then somebody walks by and says, hey, you want to go play 9? I'm like, heck yeah, let's go. It's 10:20. They haven't hit they've dropped 2 balls. They've hit 4 wedges and 2 drivers. And then on the 3rd hole, they're mad that they're, not hitting it solid. And now they're chasing swing fixes. The average golfer can prepare to play better golf to play the game. Imagine if we all worked with golf like we did basketball. If Steph Curry is missing 3-pointers, he's not standing over in the corner working on his shot between timeouts. He works his technique away from the court. But then they play a lot. They compete a lot. They scrimmage a lot. They play, games in their training. The average golfer can prepare to play better golf by competing in what they do. I'll give you an example. With my super strong grip and my bad posture, chipping has been an issue for me. And so even though I hit the ball a long way, I would sometimes resist going at par 5s and 2 because I didn't want to miss a green and then make par when I had a pretty, quote, easy chip. One of my tour players came in and he had this orange whip wedge trainer. I don't know if anybody's familiar with that. But the orange whip is a very loose shaft. And you talk about disaster for me. I mean, it was just incompatible with the way I played golf. And I had taken lessons, and I hadn't done what my buddy had told me to do in chipping. So I get the orange whip trainer out, and I'm like, I am going to figure out how to get this ball to go towards the hole and chip appropriately. And I sat out there for hours playing and fiddling with it and fixing it, moving the ball forward, moving it back, you know, weakening my grip, and whatever. And I got into a strategy that I know I can chip. My chipping has improved night and day, immense different. But what happened was I started competing. I started figuring out a way to do it. And then I was like, I'm going to go challenge myself in different areas. And I started realizing that I could actually do it. And now when I play, I feel so comfortable when I walk up to a chip. It doesn't matter the lie. It doesn't matter if it's hard lie, tight lie, fluffy lie. It doesn't matter. And so now when I go practice chipping, I hit a lot of random shots. I work a little bit on technique, and then I start competing. And I try to hit different shots. I allow myself to see things that I'm not good at. I don't try to just stay with what I am good at.
All right. How to recover from a bad start. What do you tell somebody mentally to be strong enough? You know, you start off double bogey, bogey. How do you get that player to talk to himself and realize life is not over? And that the really good players can double bogey the first hole and shoot 69.
Well, the really good players. Yeah, I mean, look, I played this weekend, and I was telling one of my clients earlier today, I played in a Wolf game this weekend, and it was all my good buddies. And, a male testosterone on the first tee started setting the bet. And I was like, oh, that's a little higher value, but all right. So, you know, here I am. Everybody knows what I do for a living. They know who I teach. They know that the number of players I have in the top 15 of the FedEx Cup. And, you know, they see these players come out there. And first hole, what do? I hit the driver right out of bounds. Made double. I made a double on a par five, completely out of play. I shot even on the front. And I had to change my mindset. Bad starts happen. How good can we be with a bad start? The truth of the matter is, so many players go into play with high expectations. They think they're going to have the day. And every golfer I know, it's like watching kids on Christmas morning. They see the excitement of all those presents out there. They're so excited to go play, and they believe that they're going to have this great day. They have all this history that they've put together of all this work and been telling their buddies, I just took a lesson, and man, I'm hitting it so good, I can't wait to show you. And then they go out and they just completely wet the bed, because their expectations got too high. And they, instead of playing golf, they're checking. And then as soon as it got hard, they got frustrated. And then they get to a spot where they get so frustrated, they essentially give up. And then just like, hell, it's already a terrible round. And then they start hitting it really, really good. So I would lower expectations. Imagine if every player walked into a round of golf and looked at it like a heavyweight fight, where you know that you're going to get beaten up. You know that you're going to get bloodied. You know that you're going to have a bad, but at the end of it, they're going to raise the hand of one person, and that person's going to have two black eyes and a broken nose, but they're going to say, man, that guy kept fighting through it and got it in the house. Look at golf that way. Don't look at golf like a beauty contest.
Yeah, but I had a junior golfer this past week, and the kid's only in the 10th grade, and he's got so much promise. He played in a tournament, a real-life tournament from the Tips, and the first day he shot 81. Next day he shoots 69. So I said, okay, what was the big difference on day two? He says, I knew I was out of it, so I just relaxed and just played.
Yep. Yep. And, you know, every player, yeah, exactly. And juniors are notorious for this. And whenever a player comes in and they tell me what's going on, you can pretty much judge what it is. First round, first day, fifth hole, it goes to hell in a handbasket. By the ninth hole, they're trying to keep it together. By the 13th hole, they've given up and they start playing good. Then the second day, they shoot 12 shots better because they don't care. And it fools them that they're good. They are good. But what they do is they think that, you know, now I'm ready for the next tournament. I got it fixed. Golfers train to fix problems. They don't train to be better players. Golfers need to train to be better players and allow the fixes to work themselves out.
I mean, I don't know, Darren, what your experience was when you were playing in the mini tours, but when I played in Europe, I said, I noticed guys that shot 76 first day and they went to their room and they pouted. And they cried like a bunch of babies. They went back out and shot 78 the next day. And the guys that shot 76 first day and you found them at the bar playing pool and drinking beers and having a hell of a time staying up late, they shot 66 the next day. They just, yep. They didn't let it faze them. They didn't let it bother them.
Well, they realize, I mean, they realize what it is. I mean, look, the game is hard. I had a player who almost won a PGA Tour event. I've had, I think our number's up to 12 that have won on the PGA Web or European Tour in the last 12 months. And I, one of my guys just came in second recently, and he texted me and said, it just wasn't my day. He said, I shot 6 under on Sunday. I lipped out on 18. I lipped out on 17. I lipped out on 15. He said they were all great putts. They just didn't go in. It just wasn't my day.
What are you going to do?
Hey, can I ask a quick question?
Sure.
I went and exercised before we did this, and I drank a liter of water. Can I take a bathroom break real quick, and I'll be back?
Absolutely. So we bring Darren on.
Okay. All right, cool. Yep.
And I understand how he feels because I'm 68 years old, and it's surprising that I haven't run to the bathroom yet.
Yeah.
So, Darren, what's going? But this is really great. But I tell you, everybody, we got to thank Darren that Darren put all this together. And and he's got more arrows in his quiver. We're going to get some other guys that are going to come up too.
Yeah, I've got a few confirmations already from some guys, and we're going to have some really good guests coming up in the next couple of weeks. So stay tuned. Keep your eyes out for the emails, and it's going to be a real treat for everyone. I mean, Dr. McCabe, I can't believe he said yes. I mean, so generous with his time, but I guess that's why he's where he's at, because he's and willing to put himself out there and help others. So we're lucky to have him on tonight.
Yeah, we really are. I mean, this is interesting, and I agree with a lot of what he's saying because, I mean, I've experienced it myself. You know, I would tell anybody, I say, you know what, you just got to take away the, you know, like I tell a lot of the kids, I tell them, I said, your parents aren't going to throw you out of the house, right? They're not going to stop feeding you. You had a bad day on the golf course. I mean, what's the big deal? Come on, let's go. Pick yourself back up and let's go back tomorrow. You know, you can't get so down in the mouth and everything that you fall apart.
Well, can I add to that though about temper and stuff and those emotions? I want every golfer listening to this to get rid of the notion that you have to be calm to play good golf. Get rid of that. That is the worst advice that has damaged more game than, well, I mean, you guys probably have some swing fixes that you could look at and say it's killed people. Get rid of the calm thing. I have more players that are trying to get in a calm state of mind and they're not playing the hole in front of them. When I was pitching, I loved adrenaline. I loved coming out of the bullpen, particularly at a visitor's place. You could play all the pump up music you wanted. I just thrived in that. So why would I have to be calm in golf? Because it's a fine motor skill? No. I actually think there's five personalities or five mindsets of playing great, great golf in the moment. The first one is a player needs to be amped up. And this goes across all sports. They need to be like me, where the reason I played so good with adrenaline is because it allowed me, it funneled my focus really, really well. And it got me away from my doubts and my fears and my, you know, technical thoughts. But there's also players that they don't want to be amped up. They want to be calm under pressure. They want to be tacticians. And I remember an offensive lineman telling me this, who's going to be a first round draft pick. He said, you know, when I'm before a game, everybody's listening to hype music, and I go off to the side and just work my steps. And he said, when I'm in the biggest moment, the biggest game, I'm not getting amped up. He said, that defensive lineman can talk as much as they want to me. And what I'm thinking is left hand up, right up, you know, up underneath the shoulder pads. He said, I'm not getting amped up because if I do, I break my technique. I had a gymnast that told me, she said, when coaches are telling me to free it up and go, she goes, I don't know what that means because I do that every time. She goes, I work on my keys. And I was like, okay, that was pretty good insight because I was always an adrenaline player. Then there's a player who goes, and I've got a tour player like this who's very successful. He says, when I'm in the heat of the moment, I want to be in a bubble. And I want to have a talk with my caddy as if he and I are playing a practice round. I feel the emotion. I love being emotional. And if people saw it from the outside, they'd say, this is a very emotional player. He says, I'm not trying to temper emotion. I'm not trying to be calm. I'm just I'm just playing a game with me and my caddy. So it's the bubble style player. Then you also have what I call the worry wart, okay? The catastrophizer. That's the person who in the heat of the moment is scared out of their mind. They will tell you everything that could go wrong, but they're brilliant at identifying all what goes wrong. And then they process it and go, well, this is, they do it subconsciously, but it's like, okay, well, this is what I can do. Just hit the shot. You know, I'll deal with it if it goes bad. But, and you know, I've played with baseball players like that, pitchers who would worry. It's like, my God, these opponents are so good. And they go out and they pitch brilliantly because it just allowed them to vocalize all the things that they were concerned about. And then the last one is what I call the chosen person. Typically, these are people who tend to be a little bit more on the spiritual side, but they feel like they're in that position for a reason. And so they accept the challenge and will accept what happens as happens. And
Uh-oh. Doc, we lost you. Oh, there you are. Doc, we lost you. Oh, darn it.
It's the worst thing to do to me because I love it. I feed off of it. So the biggest thing to do is calm me down. Give me something to drink. That's terrible for me.
I mean, everybody's different, though. And I mean, it's
100%.
I was an attack kind of guy. I mean, I wanted to attack. I wanted to attack. I saw that in Arnold Palmer so much.
Yeah, but you've got that Latin blood in you.
I think so. I don't know who my father is.
but you've got...
Are you still there? We're losing you. Oh, this damn internet.
You've got that passion. I work with a very successful guy that a lot of articles recently said, you are a bumbling idiot. You don't realize that what we see is a boil over sometimes of expectations. And sometimes, but it's how he processes it and moves it on. Now, it's not ideal. As he gets older, it'll go away. But if I told him to temper his emotions, I take away his magic. Okay, he's never done anything that's pissed off the game or been disrespectful or anything. Now, people say, well, you know, slamming a club is – well, Tiger did it forever, okay, and we loved it, right? The fact is I want him to get a healthier way, but I'm not going to change him. In fact, what I'm going to get him to do is stop fighting who he is and better communicate with his caddy when he's upset and not show as many negative emotions. But when he turns 35, trust me, it'll go away. And between now and then, I mean, we loved Patrick Reed in the Ryder Cup, right? We loved it. Well, why can't we like that? I mean, we love a football player who gets up and, you know, is waving to the crowd and going and charging around the corner. Why can't we embrace people's emotional side? Allow them to be free. But trying to be like a robot is inconsistent with being a human.
We used to say the Seve's clubs had more airtime than Iberia Airlines.
Yeah.
But that's the way he played. I mean, he played better when he was hot, you know, so.
He's Spanish. Okay. I mean, you know, he's Latin. And I mean, it'd be like taking somebody from Germany and asking him not to be organized. I have, you know, Steven Yeager, my guy I was telling you about, is German. He is very structured in the way he goes about doing things. He's German. That's what they do. That's part of the essence of who they are.
It's not me.
No, it's not me either.
Now, how about diet? And I hate to bring this one up, but performance-enhancing drug use. I mean, it's out there. It's in sports. I mean, what do you think about those two things?
Well, I haven't seen any performance-enhancing drug use in the PGA Tour, so I can't answer that at all.
Okay,
I see it in other sports. I see it in other sports. But, you know, the fact is that when there's a financial gain and there's a competitive gain, there's always very greedy capitalists who will find a way to get an edge, okay? And it doesn't matter. And we just need to identify. I think
we lost you again.
I think Bud Selig is the worst commissioner in the history of Major League Sports. He's all doing witch hunt. I think what we have to do is look at diet and say, absolutely, but you've got to eat. Golfers don't eat on the golf course. Even tour players are really bad at it. everybody listening to this, I can guarantee you, underserved on the golf course. If you go eat a breakfast at 7 a.m. and you have an 8:30 tee time, most people won't eat again until their turn, which is about 10:30 or 10:45. That's 3 hours and 45 minutes since your last meal. You'll eat something little, and then you'll make it to the final, you know, after 18, and then you're going to chow down at the, you know, at the 19th hole. And you actually were in starvation mode a couple times. So I encourage all my players to eat every two holes. And the best thing for them is to eat a peanut butter and honey on whole wheat, cut it in fours, and eat two little pieces every two holes. And I found that to be very, very successful, mixing some fruit, mixing some peanut M&Ms. But don't wait till you get in starvation mode. Diet, you know, the mind goes before the body goes. But we blame it always on the body and the swing. When actually what it –
What happened? We lost you again.
Is that we're losing our focus and we're having to rally to make decisions.
All right, got another one for you. How does your virtual training work that you have on your site?
Yeah, so we just launched this called the Mindset Academy, and it's fantastic, actually. The best deal is our annual subscription. If you go to
Let me see, where are you?
Not on there.
I had you there. Where did you go? Well, I'll tell you what we'll do here.
If you go to the Mindside Academy or the Mindside.com, and it's the easiest place to go.
I had it up. I don't know what the heck I did.
Go to the Mindside.com. And we wanted to get sports psychology on your fingertips. And if you go there, you at the upper right corner, there's a let's see if it pop up.
Here we go.
Right there, the Mindset Academy. So if you click on the Mindset Academy, it'll take you to the website where it's all housed. And there's different options available. We're cleaning up the website. We got a lot of information on there. But we've got a Mindset of Golf coming out real soon. It'll be coming out in October. It's going to be about 40 videos looking at the mental side of the game. It's what I call the attacker model. It's pretty cool, very exciting. And if you buy the annual subscription, you get everything for the year, every video we come out with. But the first major ones we came out with was called the Meeting the Moment or Winning Every Moment. Mm-hmm. And it's great. And you can download the videos. They're right there at your disposal. They're usually 3 to 6 minutes long, and they're about topics that will help you in your game. I will tell you the golf one that's coming is going to teach you everything from the, you know, assessing your game to developing your training to testing that, to getting ready in the anticipation phase of play, to competing, to gaining knowledge, and then reinvesting in your game. And we're going to launch a coach's model that comes with it. That'll be in addition. And then I think it's going to be really, really good. It'll teach you the way that I have players learn motor skills, which is different than the average person. And the reason for that is I want them to gain confidence and mastery versus fixing problems.
Now, looking at your books, just me thinking of some of our students, for a junior golfer, it's a high school golfer trying to get a college scholarship, which one of these books would you recommend for them?
Well, first thing I would do is have them get the journal. And the journal is to teach them how to analyze and grow round to round, day to day. Golfers are really, really bad at managing their game and learning from what they did today. Well, what they do is because they don't journal and they don't keep, you don't keep the process moving, that what happens is they allow the emotion of the moment to give them the impression of how they're doing. So a good day, they feel great about themselves. A bad day, they feel like an idiot. And the journal allows them to go back in and have a process to evaluate every day and to build a plan for that day. That's where I'd start. The manifesto, the Mindset Manifesto book, is the book that pretty much goes into all my concepts, and it's about what you really want and doing what it takes to achieve it. And then the game plan is a supplement that goes with that.
All right, and they can buy any one of these right here online.
Yep. I'll sign them. If you buy them from us, I'll sign them for you and get them out to you.
Oh, so just put on there by way of Darren or Darren and the Wild Cube.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
The manifesto is a game changer. It's a must for everyone.
I appreciate that.
It's a must.
I appreciate that.
No, I'm
it
a
was
go ahead, I'm sorry.
Work in progress. I was gonna say it was a work in progress. I mean, it was I didn't know what I was actually writing when I started. I put it off for a long time. That's why I do the podcast. Is I started the podcast so I wouldn't have to write a book. And the idea was that, you know, as I sat there for a while and somebody said, you just need to write all your ideas down before somebody starts and runs with them. And it was funny. It actually saved me on something. I was in the middle of our member guest and I get my wife gets a cease and desist letter from a guy about a concept. And he's like, I think Dr. McCabe has inadvertently stolen my content. And she's like, oh my God, I'm so sorry. That was probably just an overlook. And I was like, I've never heard of this guy before. Well, come to find out, he had published something 2 years after I published my book. It was in my book. And I couldn't find, and I'm like, thank you. thank you for rooting around for me and thinking I'm doing something inappropriate, which was not. And thank God it was in the book, because now he's moved on and realized it was just an inadvertent overlap between two people that were hitting on the same topic. So
everybody tries to, you know, take a piece of somebody else's success and without earning it themselves. And that's the thing. But it's not because you're online with us right now, but I'm a big believer in the mental thoughts in your head when you're playing golf. I mean, I've just experienced it too much in my own life. And I know from having played a little bit myself, I mean, different things that guys told me, like Roberto Di Vicenzo. I look at a guy and I say, look at a nice swing. He says, don't look at him. He says, don't look at him. You don't know the guy with the nicest swing going to come in last. Don't look at his swing. You know, certain things that you just learn to do when you had a bad hole, and you learn how to shake it off and learn so much is in your mind. It's so much is the way you think when you're performing. I mean, you can't,
to your point,
without controlling your mind.
Every player has fears. Every player has doubts. Every player has confidence issues at times. And it's so funny. I'll work with a player and lately, you know, I started working with Billy Horschel back in at Tampa, March. Billy's been very honest and talked about our work a lot whenever he's been in the lead or whatever. And he's so honest. What's that?
Yeah, you're there. Go ahead. We got you there.
What'd you say?
You go ahead. Go ahead.
Okay. And Billy's so awesome. Yep. Okay. Billy's awesome. But what Billy will talk about is, like, he'll do an interview and he'll say, hey, I just went, you know, let's talk to Brett again. We got back to our plan. Because the natural mind is to go, well, I'm doing this. Let's reach out for something more. And it's like, no, do what you do exceptionally well and keep doing it.
Does anybody have some questions real quick before we call it a night? Let me look in the chat box and see. You can put your questions right in the chat box. Or I go up the microphones, but then we'll probably have a bunch of feedback and stuff. Let me see.
I've got one, Bobby.
Go ahead.
I've got one. I was always a fan of Jack Nicklaus.
Who is this? Larry? Sounds like Larry.
Yeah, this is Larry. I'm an LSU grad.
What? No Tiger. Hey, you too, huh?
Yeah, absolutely. Twice. But I'm a lot older. I'm a lot older than you are. 69 and 70.
I probably sat in the exact same buildings as you, and you graduated.
I'm sure you did. Yeah, 69 and 70. But anyway, my question: can you hear me?
Joey with my father-in-law, probably. So,
well, my question is this:
oh, I lost you.
Okay.
Oh, there.
Can you hear me now? Can you hear me now?
Yep, I got you now.
Okay.
Yep.
All right. Nicklaus always said that he would hit the shot that would take bogey out of play. He might not be able to make, it's a par five, so he may not be able to make an eagle with the shot he would make, but he would make sure that he would hit a shot that would not cost him bogey if he missed it. So how does that kind of coincide with your suggestion to attack the course?
Well, the attack in the course is based on the strategy that gives you the highest chance for success with the least amount of risk, right? Even if we have a target that's the middle of the green, I want you to attack it. That's where that's where you want the ball to go to. And I've done a lot of reading and following a buddy of mine by the name of Scott Fawcett, who has come out with a concept called Decade, which is a course strategy that has had a lot of adoption and success on the tour, but and a lot with junior players. And his thing is, look, there are times where you go and you make you attack a hole in a pin, but there's other times where you take bogey out of play, and you got to accept your natural dispersion of your shot shape. So if you've got a back right pin and you don't cut the ball, you draw it, maybe going 20 feet left of the pin is a smart play and give yourself a chance to make the putt, but you take away everything. You take.
I lost you the end there.
Away all the risk.
There you go.
So, you know, it was kind of like me as a pitcher, right? I had to set them up, and you got to set up the game to work for you.
Now, you as a pitcher, let me say that. I played catcher. And I tell you what, I really love seeing a guy that can really work a baseball. I'm not impressed with these clowns that can throw in 105 miles an hour like a goose gossage or something. They do it for two innings, and then they got to go away. I like to see a guy that can really work the baseball and make it go in so many different directions that the batters are just they don't know what to do with themselves. Do you agree with that, or do you like the fast pitch kind?
Well, I think it's different strokes for different folks. I mean, the Houston Astros have had a lot of success of just bringing in flamethrowers and throwing it by guys. And there comes a point where the human brain cannot respond to a super fast fastball. But Greg Maddux had a lot of success taking a 90 mile an hour fastball and making it move. But I don't think we could take Justin Verlander and make him Greg Maddux. And so I think we have to know who we are and go. I mean, I think there's nothing better than a well-pitched baseball game. I think it's brilliant because it's a game of ultimate chess where players are working to beat one another and they're matching wits. And so that's what makes it so great. I think golf and pitching are so similar because it's the strategy to set up the game to work for you. And you got to stay present from shot to shot, pitch to pitch. You can never give one up because if you do, that's when you always get punished.
Well, you get a guy with a good sinker. I'm telling you what, as a catcher, you get sick and tired of digging them out of the dirt all night long.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
But you love seeing guys swing at it, and it just goes right underneath their bat. I mean, it's amazing. So I love seeing a guy that can move the ball. So any questions, Darren? If not, we'll call it a night.
No, I think we've taken enough of the Doc's time here. Yep. I really appreciate it. Some really good information, really good insight. And I would encourage everybody to get the manifesto. Like I said, it's a game changer. And to start listening to some of Dr. McCabe's podcasts. There's so many good people that he talks to on these podcasts. I would encourage everybody to start listening to them. It's really, really great information.
And I tell you what, thank you for saying that. There's a great one that I did recently with Phil Blackmore from the Golf
Channel. Oh, it was awesome.
So and it was a brilliant, it. Brilliant.
Yeah. So where do they find those on your site? Where do they find them on your site?
You know what? That's a good question. They may not be on our site right now. If you go to
It's on there.
Is it on there? Okay. Yep. Yeah, you'll find them on there.
It is. Yeah, I saw it.
You did?
Okay, good.
Okay, good.
Phil Blackmore's genius. Yeah. He's brilliant.
All right.
And it's brilliant.
I'm going to go ahead and put this on YouTube if you don't mind, Doc. So, and then send an email to all our gang, get them to watch it, and hopefully they'll get some books from you. And we owe you big time.
Thank you very much. Y'all have a good one, okay?
If you ever get arrested in Cuba, just call me. I'll get you out. Good night.
Good night.
Thank you. Good night. Thank you.
Good night, Chet. Good night, David.
You don't know why my internet keeps falling. Thank you, guys. You got it.